Yes, sir.
Okay. Very good morning to all of you.
Good morning.
Dear Dr. Raju, co-chair, Dr. Gunjan Bhandari, rapporteur, and dear participants. Hearty welcome all of you in this technical seminar 7. There are 12 speakers in this session. The papers to be presented in this session covers a wide range of topics such as R&D role in sustainable development, use efficiency, market infrastructure, organizational role of upstream actors like banking sector, entrepreneurial behavior, opportunities and challenge of agribusiness industry, and effect of climate change also to be covered in this session. All these issues are very pertinent from inclusive growth and sustainability point of view. Friends, we have limited times, so each presenter will be given 10 minutes. And after completion of all presentations, we will have a discussion session of 15 to 20 minutes. So now I request Dr. R. Raju to directly invite the speakers and also request Dr. Gunjan to record the proceeding. Dr. Raju, please.
Yeah, good morning to all of you. Welcome to today's seminar. As our chairman sir told, we have limited time and there are 12 participants who is going to present their slide. So each participant will get 10 minutes. So I don't want to repeat. Okay. I request participant to speak on their time. Please follow the guidelines, whatever told by chairman and co-chairman. Let's welcome all of you. Let's start the presentation there.
Dr. Dilip, invite Dr. Dilip. Okay, then go to next presentation.
Yeah. Sri Raj Jaiswal.
Yes, sir.
You are there?
Yes, sir, I am there, sir.
Yeah, you can please start your presentation.
Okay, thank you. Slides are visible, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. So, a very good morning to the respected chairperson, co-chairperson, sir, reporter, and my dear colleagues. Today, I am going to present my paper entitled Overview of Agriculture Industry in India, Opportunities and Challenges. So, coming with the outline of the outline of my presentation. It consists of introduction, outline of an agribusiness system, methodology, result and discussion, including the opportunities and challenges, followed by the conclusion. Introduction. Agriculture and allied sector, being a backbone of the Indian economy, provides employment and livelihood for the majority of the population of the country. Agriculture has turned its face from traditional form to the agribusiness form. According to the, yes, sir.
Excuse me, Mr. Raj.
Excuse me, sir.
We are not able to see your slides.
Better, Raj, you may kindly share your slides.
Yeah.
Okay. Sir, is it visible, sir?
No.
I think you have not shared your slides.
Sir, I have shared it.
Is it visible to you?
No slides.
Now
it is visible.
We got visible.
Now it is visible.
Okay, yes. Thank you, sir. Sorry for the interruption. So, coming, I was discussing about the introduction part. According to the Davis and Goldberg that belongs to the Harvard Business School, they defined the agribusiness as the sum total of the all operations operations involved in the manufacture and distribution of the farm supplies, production operation of the farm, and the shortage, storage, processing, distribution of the resulting farm commodities. So agribusiness mainly consists of four distinct subsectors that are agriculture input, agriculture production part, the processing and the marketing and the trade. Outline of an agribusiness system is here, where seed, fertilizer, pesticide, machinery, equipment, water, power, fuel and services. These are the input part. And then there is a production system. Production system consists of crop production, livestock production, forest products, and other fisheries products. Then coming to the processing and marketing and trade. The processing and marketing and trade are interlinked, where we have marketers, importers, then processing through food use, non-food use, and there is export and import. So all these in the are interrelated with each other. Coming to the methodology, the current study is purely based on the secondary data collected from the various sources, and based on these data, the results are analyzed. Coming to the result and discussion, opportunities of the agribusiness sector. Agribusiness sector contributes about 14.4% of the GVA to the economy. The share of the pure farming may decline. The share of the whole agriculture, including the agribusiness, will not, as it is the necessity of the country. After 1990, there was a foreign direct investment came in where the FDI inflow came and the export of the agriculture product increased, and we became a global partner. India became a net exporter of the agri food products after liberalization. So the major opportunities in the agribusiness sector is that the pattern of agriculture land holding, gross value added in agriculture, gross capital formation in agriculture and allied sectors, share of public and private sector in the total GCF, FDI investment, crop wise demand availability of the seeds, then export statement of the principal product in agriculture, expenditure on the agriculture research and education. Coming with the pattern of the agricultural land holding, the proportion of the marginal farmer in the total operational holding increased from 62% to 68% in 2015 and 16. These changes shows that though the number of the marginal farmer are increasing, but there is a chance to indulge these marginal farmer in agribusiness sector so that they can have an extra income. The area operated by the marginal and small farmer increased. Also, that means the number of the large farmers are decreasing. So there is a need to attract these farmers in an agribusiness sector. Then gross value added in agriculture. Gross value added, the growth of the gross agriculture sector in terms of gross value is on cyclic movement. Gross value added agriculture declined from 5.6% in 13-14 to a negative 0.2% in 14-15. Then it improved to 6.3%. The crop, livestock and forestry sector showed a fluctuating growth rate over the period of from 15 to 16. Fishery sector has shown a rapid growth. So there can be intervention in fishery sector and livestock sector, which are showing a better growth rate. Then gross capital formation in agriculture. There is an increase in the gross capital formation in agriculture, both in private and public. But the growth in the public sector is better. GVA increased from 16.5% in 12-13 to 17.7% in 13-14, but later it declined in 17 and 18. So there is a need for the more private investment so that the gross capital formation from the private sector could be increased, which can be through the food processing or through agribusiness. Then share of public and private sector in total GCF, as it is showing that the share of the private sector is declining, and it is from 85.7% to 82.7%, but again the share of the public sector is increasing. There should be more participation of the private sector in the agribusiness industry so that it can flourish well. Coming to the FDI investment in agriculture, FDI equity inflow is highest in food and processing industries in comparison with the agriculture machinery, sugar and vegetable and vegetable oils. Though agriculture food processing industry has shown the peak in between 2014 and 15, where the government allowed the FDI rates has changed. And vegetable and vegetable oil also, along with the agriculture services and other subsectors, are also attracting the FDI inflows. Then coming to the industry of the seed, we can see that the crop-wise demand for the certified seed. So here we can see that the availability is more than the demand. So we can have an area of export of these certified and quality seeds and have a business in seed industry. The total availability is more than the total demand. Oil seed and fiber sectors are those where the demand is higher than the available seeds. So we have to improve in this also. The export statement of the principal products, we can see the value of export is increasing in animal products, and that it increased from 4,392 million US dollar to 4,610. It again declined. And the cereals, we have seen that there is an increase in value of the export. Cereal, animal products, and processed food contribute to the major share of the agriculture export, and there are ample opportunities in the export of agri products and services. Expenditure on the agricultural research and education, we are seeing that though there is increase in the share of expenditure on the research, but it is quite low, and there is an opportunity to make investment in the agricultural research so that we can have a better technology and we can harvest the opportunities here. The major challenges are industrial sickness, marketing problem, managerial problem, and quality control infrastructure issues and financial crisis. There is a paucity of the raw materials and lack of research and poor management. Small agribusiness are not in the position to train and develop. So there is a lack of trained staff also. So major challenges agribusiness industry is that there is poor marketing facilities, absence of efficient marketing network leading to a poor marketing and distribution are the major challenge. Inefficient finance to develop good industry, we need a large financial requirement for the purchase of machinery equipment, which is not available. Resource and power shortages, that is basic raw materials required, are critical. There is problem of quality and quantity both. And there is underutilization of the plant capacity. Adequate infrastructure facilities are not available. The transportation warehouses and facilities are not up to the mark. And more than 30% of the agriculture production are perishable in nature. And so there is a loss due to the poor infrastructure and scarcity of the trained human resources. There is shortage of trained personnel. In agribusiness industry, that is those persons which have a drive and expertise in these. Then is the obsolescent technology, means the technology is outdated and we need to change it. Poor management and organization operate, as the agribusiness sector is mainly operated by the owners and they don't have the professional skills. And the research and development activity, as we have seen that the investment in the research and the development is very low. So we have to put efforts. The other problems is that the agriculture products are perishable in nature. Poor capacity utilization due to seasonality. And coming to the conclusion, the agribusiness industry in India has lots of opportunities along with the many constraint. Agriculture is now shifting from pure production to the other sectors, including the food processing and the input industries. Small land holdings, the majority of the population are dependent on the key features of Indian agriculture. Agribusiness provided the insight to the input industry, processing industry, agriculture industry, marketing, farm machinery, and other industries. There is a need of more investment in agriculture along with the technological and the human capital development, and they should focus on the more capital investment, research, and skill development. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Raj.
Thank you.
Nice presentation. Dr. Anil.
Yeah, Dr. Raj.
Shall we ask question answer in between or we'll keep in the last? What do you say?
Depend upon time.
Okay.
Okay, we can take it at the last if okay. We have less number of presenters. I think presenters are still adding. So we should move to the next, I think.
Okay, then.
We will take.
Okay. We'll keep the question answer session at the last after all presentation. Now I invite the next presenter, Sri Afreen Jaina.
Good morning to everyone.
Yeah.
Now I am I'll be sharing my screen of my presentation. Today I'll be presenting on the topic distribution and determinants of land fallow among the farmers of central and dry zone of Karnataka. I'll be having a flow of presentation, like I'll be giving a little introduction or the background, and then discuss important methodology, then discussion and conclusion. So among the two options available to increase the agriculture production, that is either by increasing the land productivity or bringing more land under production, the less explored option is by bringing more land under agriculture production. Though India is ranked second in the total arable land in the world, but it is having about 60% of the arable land which is left fallow. And also several studies have been reported that there is a continuous decline in the cultivable land, and also there is a sharp increase in the land put for non-agriculture uses in the last 4 decades. Thus, the pressure on agriculture land can be overcome through optimum utilization of land which is kept under fallow. So to address this issue, the study has been taken up in the central dry zone of Karnataka, which is the major part of Tumkur district. And the study is based on the primary data consisting of about 120 sample farmers, which includes both small farmers and large farmers who are having irrigation and also who are rain fed. So to model the decision of the farmers to keep the certain percent of their land fallow, Tobit regression model has been employed. This is used because Tobit regression has been employed because the dependent variable used here is a percentage of the land kept fallow by the farmers, which is having a skewed distribution, which can be clear from this graph. When we could see that the normal, even though if we plot a normal distributed curve over the sample farmer size, sample data, this is showing a skewed distribution. Therefore, Tobit regression has been employed. Where the y, that is the dependent variable, is share of the land holding which is kept fallow, and there are several explanatory variables which have been included. So to give a basic picture of the land fallow distribution among the farmers, here we could see that large farmers are having more of the land which is kept fallow for a long time, which could be seen from the picture that more of the farmers, like large farmers, are having cultivable wastelands compared to small farmers. And the average area left fallow by the small farmer is comparatively percentage land which is kept fallow by the small farmers who are under a rain-fed condition is surprisingly lower than the farmers who are even having irrigation facility and larger land holdings. So coming to the distribution of the farmers on the basis of the area which is kept under fallow, we could see that of the 30 farmers, small farmers who are under a rain-fed condition, having only 9 farmers are having the land fallow, compared to the large farmers which are showing almost 10% land fallow. There is also a relationship observed between the land fallow and also the presence of migrant members in the family. Here we could see that the farmers who are having migrant member in the family are tend to keep the land fallow more than the farmers who are having non-migrant members. And there are several effort has been made to study the reason for leaving the land fallow through the opinion survey, and the major reason or the major cause who stated by the farmer to leave the land fallow is scanty rainfall or the problem with the irrigation water, and which is followed by the poor land fertility status. And the large farmers also have the problem of labor management, lack of credit, and also distance from the residents. This is the overall picture or the average respondents' opinion. Here we could see that more than 40% of the farmers are having the issue of scanty rainfall or the irrigation problem, which is followed by the poor land fertility status. Here, to model the decision
Hello, Apre. Hello. Hello, Apre. Hello.
Am I audible now?
Yes, you can.
Yes. Okay. So, and the other variable which affecting the decision of the farmer is the farm family labor available per acre, which is showing the negative relationship with the decision of the farmer. Which? Yes, sir.
We cannot see your slides.
Sorry, I'll share it again. Can you give me just a moment? Sir, is it visible now?
No.
No,
it's not.
Sir, is it visible now?
Yeah. You can proceed.
Yeah.
Yes, visible now.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So here we can see from the regression that if the farmer farm family size increases, that the farm labor increases by 1%, about 20% of the land kept fallow, percentage of the land kept fallow could be decreased. And contrary to the results we obtained from the opinion survey, here we could see that the distance of the land from the residence, poor fertility status, and lack of credit of credit for investment are also the major reason for the decision of the farmer to keep the land fallow. And here the wall statistic shows the overall significance of the model. So to conclude this study, the farmers in the dry zone in India have a high tendency for leaving their land fallow. And to decipher this phenomenon, the study has been conducted in Tumkur district of central dry zone of Karnataka. And the results of the study revealed that there is a positive relationship between the size of the land holding and also the land fallow. And the major reason stated by the farmer to leave their land fallow was scarcity of the reason, scarcity of rainfall or irrigation water, which was followed by the poor land fertility status. And contrary to the general belief that the availability of irrigation would bring more land under cultivation, the results have revealed that with availability of irrigation water, there is a increase in share of the total land which is kept fallow. So hence there is a need to put more effort to increase the cultivation of drought tolerant crops in such regions. And also, since there is a labor availability at the problem of labor availability at the farm level, which significantly impact the farmer's decision to keep their land fallow, there is a need for extension activities to encourage the rural youth to continue to work in their fields, to continue to work in their fields. Thank you.
Thank you,
Ms. Afrinjana, for nice presentation. Now I will call upon the next presenter, Mr. Kuldeep Singh. He is going to present. Is there, Mr. Kuldeep?
Good morning, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah, audible.
Sir, I'm just Kiran Kaur.
Okay. You are going to present.
It's a joint paper by. Yeah, it's a joint paper, sir, and I'll be presenting this paper.
It's okay. Yeah, you please start.
Good morning, one and all present here, sir. Is my PPT visible?
PPT is not visible. Yeah,
it is visible.
It's visible. Good morning, one and all present here. I'm just. Should I start, sir?
Drop हो गया था मेरा भी फिर मैंने specific किया है नहीं आया hello
should I start, sir?
Yeah, you can start.
Good morning, one and all. I'm just Kiran Kaur, research scholar from Punjabi University, Patiala. And the topic of my presentation is role of research and development in sustaining Indian agriculture, a brief review. So technology united with research and development, it has evolved as a grave differentiator of agriculture sector in India, including production, processing, agriculture, packaging, marketing of given crops. Indian economy is agrarian economy and the majority of population is engaged in agriculture sector, but its share in the GDP in comparison to that is very low. Agriculture has transformed significantly over the past few decades, but when it comes to the investment in research and development, there is a lot more which needs to be done. So objective of my study is, first of all, I'll give an overview of R&D development in India since independence. Second objective of my study is to see how much spendings on research and development have been done from 2000 to 2014. And at last, I will address some issues faced by the various institutions in implementing these plans. So coming to the evolution of R&D policies in India, concept of science and technology in agriculture sector, it was firstly adopted by Europe economy in the 17th century. After that, the concept of experimental farming was further boosted by the establishment of Royal Agricultural Society of England in year 1790, and later on for the scientific farmer, establishment of Department of Agriculture in England. So when it comes to the concept of research and development in agriculture sector, it continued even after India got independence with several changes from time to time for boosting the sustainable agriculture. Agriculture Review team of Independent India that was chaired by M.U. Parker of USDA, he recommended various reforms regarding the management and organization structure of agriculture research in the country in 1963, where in different research centers, they come under the ICAR. ICAR is a main head center at the federal level, and different research centers come under one roof. Apart from this, various state agriculture universities were established for dealing in corresponding changes at state level. Now here comes the organizational development. Main organization in this field is ICAR, and various other research institutes come under its administration, including more than 100 institutions. SAUs, that is State Agricultural Universities, they are a success in India up to an extent, as central agency of ICAR, it coordinates, funds and intimates to SAU timely that why this ICAR SAU model has been adopted by many Asian and African economies. So apart from these SAUs and ICAR, there are several institutions like Department of Biotechnology, Department of Science and Technology, which are here for the research and development purposes. Another program named that is Agriculture Technology Management Agency. It was linked with the Krishi Vigyan Kendras and SAUs for the purpose of technology transfers. ICAR SAU refine the technology and disseminate the information through agriculture technology information centers. Agriculture extensive program, that is training and visit system, it was also established, but it was not a success up to that point. Now, trends and pattern of research and development in India, the data I have collected from ASTI. Here I have taken the three components, that what is the total agriculture R&D spending, how many researchers are there, and what is the total agriculture research intensity. Basically, agriculture research intensity, we find it as a ratio of public R&D spending to the national GDP, that how much portion of our national GDP it is spent on the R&D purposes, especially for the agricultural purposes. So if you see from year 2000 to 2014, agriculture R&D, it has increased, but the number of researchers or outcomes, it has decreased. It means government is spending. If government is spending, we need to get some outcomes, but the outcomes are not up to that point. And there are several reasons behind this, which I'll be discussing in the next part. So finding from the given table clearly depicts over the time period, total agriculture spending, it has increased, but agriculture spending as a percentage of total output, it has remained the same. Then economic survey 2017 and 18, it said that India's GDP is almost constant, 0.6 to 0.7%. If you compare this with the developed economies, it is very less. Like you see in the US economy, though these are not the agrarian economies. Initially they were, but now they are not the agrarian economies. If you see in US economy, it is 2.8. In China, it is 2.1. And Indian economy, which is agrarian economy, there this percentage is very less. That is 0.6 to 0.7%. Now, there are very benefits of R&D in sustaining the Indian agriculture. If you will go for research and development, it is going to help the Indian farmers, because like genetic modification of seeds, BT cotton was introduced a few years back. So that all are the outcomes of R&D. If R&D will be there, we will be able to produce the disease resistant crops with the help of various insecticides and fertilizers, pesticides. Water management can be done, that how the underground, because we know that basically our economy or our agricultural, it depends upon the monsoon. But efficient water management can be done if R&D is there. environment friendly agriculture, like we most of the economies are now focusing on the sustainable agriculture. That is, we have to use the resources in a way that it can be sustained for the future generation also. So environment friendly agriculture, that how much of insecticides, pesticide, fertilizer we should use, all this can be are the outcomes of the R&D. And at the last, agriculture technology that help us to produce more crops within the less time. Now, these are the emerging issues. Besides the success of Indian R&D in corresponding to national challenges, various regulatory issues related to complexity of research can't be ignored. Along with the sustainability, as we are focusing on the sustainability of natural resources, but along with this, there are various goals which later on get conflicted with each other, like environment safety, efficient and inclusive growth, nutritive and quality product, etc. Not only compliance of international commitment is required, role of stakeholder in decision making is equivalent important. Say, if we are importing something or some technology from outside, it is not only that you are importing that technology, apart from that, how you implement that, how much people are participating, how small farmers are going through that, it is also important. Another challenge is regarding the strengthening of SAUs, like State Agriculture University. ICAR can help in mobilizing the funds for infrastructure development and for maintenance of critical minimum strength of faculty and in various disciplines. This will integrate the technology and knowledge at the regional level through research education linkages and assist their flows to farmers. Lack of skilled manpower and funds is another major weakness in public extension, which reduces the overall effectiveness of R&D agriculture sector. ATMA, like ATMA, I have already discussed about this. It was linked with the KV case, but they were not, this information is not properly dismantled to the farmer. So conclusions of the study concluded that amount of resources that we have pooled into R&D showed least result, as till date there are many problems faced in the paving of the sustainable development. R&D continued in the pre and post independent era has not shown a significant growth in R&D. Government should not focus on the financial help. As I have already discussed, it is not only that you are pulling the financial resources, you are giving the money to the farmers. Apart from that, you should give some extension services. You should provide some information to the farmers that how they can take the loans, how they can have an access to these financial services. Various reforms were taken from time to time in public extension system, which further improved the delivery to farmers, thus leading to higher productivity and higher income. But challenges lies with the sustainable funding of these institutions. It should not be like that if you are taking the finances today and let it use for the one time. It should be used in a sustainable way and should be invested properly. And the role of government in this is very important, because it is very easy for the large farmers to adopt it. But when it comes to the small and marginal farmer, it is difficult for them to opt these R&D policies. And the outcomes of R&D policies are out of the reach of the small and marginal farmers. So role of government in any economy is very important. Extension system should be built a strong connection between various stakeholders and farmer directly, so that farmer can easily access to farm services and can gain a market access. Government should increase the investment also, and your policies, it should be accountable and transparent. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Deskiranpa, for a nice presentation. Now I'll call upon the next participant, Ms. Soumya Mohapatra, is going to present on role of milk market infrastructure for sustainable dairy development. Yeah, before starting her presentation, I have one request for the all of the audience. I request all the audience be present till the end of this session, because we are going to take up the question answer session at the end, as you all given the instruction in the beginning, and based on your performance, we have to refer one best participant for the final award also. So once again, I request all the participants be there online till the end of the session. Okay. Now I request Ms. Soumya for presentation. Soumya.
Thank you.
सौम्य Okay, kindly share your slides and you start your presentation.
Sir, actually, I am unable to hear anything.
Sorry? Hello? Sun rahe hain? Sunna? Aapka speaker mein kuch problem hoga, check kar lena.
Yes sir.
सुन रहे अभी?
Sir, can you hear me?
हाँ हाँ.
Yes. Yes, you are audible, Soumya. You may start now. First, you share your PPT on screen, and then start.
PPT शेयर करो. सौम्या आपका पीपीटी नहीं दिख रहा. Yeah, yeah. You are audible, but your slides are not visible. Slide share karo. पहले अनम्यूट करो अपने आप. अनम्यूट करो.
सर, कैन यू हियर मी?
हाँ हाँ, अभी आवाज आ रही है. Yeah, you can share your slides and you start your presentation.
Okay, sir, just a minute. Is it visible?
Yeah. नहीं, स्लाइड्स अभी नहीं आई है. नीचे देखो, नीचे शेयर उस पर जाओ. ओके.
Is this okay now?
Yeah, yeah. You can start.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, everyone. Myself Soumya Mahapatra, and today I'm going to present on the topic role of milk market infrastructure for sustainable dairy development. This is the flow of my presentation. Coming to introduction, what is sustainable development? Sustainable development is a broad concept which literally means that the judicious utilization of resources to meet our the needs of our present generation without compromising the ability of the future generations to meet their own needs. And sustainable development broadly includes social progress, social equity, that means equitable distribution of resources, and conserving natural resources means without mutation we can rationally use the natural resources. These three factors currently will give rise to a stable and steady economic growth of a nation or a whole world. Coming to sustainable development goals, United Nations adopted 20 sustainable development goals in 2015, which is having a broad objective of poverty alleviation, elimination of hunger and malnutrition, attainment of peace and prosperity for the people of whole the world. And coming to Indian context, India is mainly focusing on two broad sustainable development goals. Those are elimination of poverty and elimination of hunger and malnutrition. All the 17 sustainable development goals are interrelated and integrated, which are maintaining balance between socioeconomic as well as environmental sustainability. And coming to Indian agricultural context, Indian agriculture is predominantly is crop and livestock based. Indian economy is mostly agrarian economy, which is crop and livestock based. And the Indian dairy sector has been emerging on a it is having an impressive performance from last three decades. As we can see, the share of livestock sector to agricultural GDP has been continuously increasing from 17% in 1970s up to 25.6% in present time. And India has also attained the status of highest milk producing nation in the world with an annual production of 187.7 million tons of milk production. But despite of being the highest milk producing nation, still the food and nutritional security in case of milk and milk products, it has been a major challenge for India which is need to be addressed. And also India is still it is also having a high level of hunger and malnutrition, which is broadly it should be addressed for attainment of sustainable development goals. Coming to market infrastructure, the performance of dairy sector is mainly influenced by the market infrastructure, as poor market infrastructure leads to inefficient utilization of resources as well as inequitable distribution pattern. And as we can see from this chart, that efficient marketing will give rise to the improvement in supply chain efficiency. That means after improvement in supply chain, we can see in both aspects from producers and consumers point of view how it is helping to attain the sustainable goals in Indian context. After improvement of supply chain efficiency, the producer is able to dispose its milk and milk products smoothly from farm to a consumer's doorstep with a reduced marketing cost, and as a result he is getting remunerative price for that. And ultimately it helps to reduce the poverty level at producer's level. And on the other hand, at consumer's level, due to improvement in supply chain efficiency, the availability of quality milk and milk product, it is increasing at consumer's level, and consumers are able to get the quality milk and milk products there is price. So it is ultimately leads to reduction in malnutrition at consumers level, and it also helps to attain food and nutritional security as a for the nation as a whole. And coming to the materials and methods chosen for during this research, I selected 21 states for this study, which I have been highlighted, and these 21 states selected, they are collectively contributing around 97% of total milk production of India. And 10 core indicators have been selected by doing extensive literature review as well as availability of secondary data from authentic sources like some published government reports or some government official websites also. And I have taken your data for three consecutive years from 2015 to 2018 to measure the temporal progress of data and the mean value of the 3 years of data obtained, that these are taken for consideration for further analysis. This table is showing the 10 common selected indicators and their respective sources, like number of dairy cooperative society, milk producer members, average milk procurement, liquid milk marketing, capacity of chilling infrastructure. These data have been collected from Environment of Energy from 2018. Then data for ease of doing marketing, it has been collected from Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion. And data for access to market information by extension activities, it has been collected from Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare website. Average area served per market, it has been collected from Economic Survey of India. Then length of Pakka Road and number of telephones per 1,000 population, which is commonly known as tele-density of population, it has been collected from Statistical Yearbook from 2015 to 2018. Then coming to Market Infrastructure Index Development, before calculation of individual Market Infrastructure Index, the basic step is to normalization of the indicators. Normalization has been done to make the data comparable as well as make them scale-free so that we can develop a index, unit-free index as a market infrastructure index. And out of 10 selected indicators, 9 indicators are positively related to market infrastructure, and the one indicator, that is average area served per market, it is negatively related with the market infrastructure. Then these are the formula used for normalization. Normalization value for positively related factor, the formula is actual value minus minimum value divided by maximum value minus minimum value. And the for negative related factors, the formula is maximum value minus actual value divided by minus minimum value. Here the maximum value represents the higher value for that particular index among the ones, value for that particular index indicator among the 21 state value of the rate which are taking into consideration. And after doing normalization, the next step is analysis by doing principal component analysis by using statistical software. And after doing principal component analysis, different ways of and then market infrastructure index are calculated by using this formula, summation of XWI divided by summation of WI. Here the XI is the normalized value of each indicators and WI is the weight assigned to each of the indicators. Then after calculation of the index, all the 21 states have been classified into high, moderate and low categories. The states coming under high infrastructure has more than means required. These are having index value within a range of mean minus 0.5 standard deviation and mean plus 0.5 standard deviation. And the states coming under low index value categories, they are having index value which is less than mean 0.5 standard deviation. The result in discussion, this table is showing the all the triennium ending values of the selected indicators for respective states. And here the yellow color highlighted values are denoting the highest value for that particular indicator. And the green color highlighted values are showing the values for that of that particular lowest value for that particular indicator. After doing principal component analysis, here we can see the scree plot showing the eigenvalue and principal components. Here three principal components have been generated which are having about 75% of cumulative variability present in this transformed data. This table is showing individual weights which have been assigned to all the 10 selected indicators. Highest weight, that is 4.22, it has been assigned to liquid milk marketing, and lowest weight, that is 2.32, it has been assigned to the indicator length of Pakka Road per square kilometer area of the state. And this figure is showing all the category wise distribution of all the 21 selected states. Like yellow color highlighted states are showing the high market infrastructure index, green color are showing the moderate, and blue color is showing the low milk market infrastructure index states. Then as I have told that we consider standard deviation value for 21 states are categorized into three groups, low, moderate, and high market infrastructure index categories. Out of which six states, these are coming under high market infrastructure index category, which are having the index value greater than 0.863. Then seven states are coming under moderate market infrastructure index category with index value within a range of 0.2478 and 0.3863, and remaining eight states are coming under low market infrastructure index categories. Those are having index value less than 0.2478. Then as we can see that Gujarat is having highest market infrastructure index, that is 0.716. This is due to Gujarat is a very well equipped and well balanced it is having a well-equipped infrastructural system throughout the state, and be it in highest number of highest rate of this very the responsiveness towards membership in a cooperative society, be it chilling infrastructure or in the state. And next to Gujarat, Karnataka is having the second highest market infrastructure index, that is 0.523. This is due to it is a well balanced state within it is having a very well balanced infrastructure which is equitable equally distributed throughout the state. Like it is having a the highest number of membership in that cooperative society, chilling infrastructure, good. It is also having a good, very good market system, which collectively these are making the Karnataka to be a very well developed market infrastructure state. And on the other hand, you can say Chhattisgarh is having the lowest market infrastructure index, that is 0.119. This is due to the state is having a very poor performance in all aspects of infrastructure, like lowest number of cooperative society, milk procurement, be it in chilling infrastructure facilities, road and infrastructure. These all are having very less developed in Chhattisgarh. Then this figure is showing the category. States according to their market infrastructure index. Yellow color highlighted states are showing the high market infrastructure index. Then green color states are showing the moderate index, and blue color highlighted portion of the low milk market infrastructure index states. This table is showing the contribution of milk to total milk production of India by different categorized group of milk market infrastructure index. Like the states which are coming under high market infrastructure states, they are collectively contributing 39.50% to total milk production. Staying under moderate infrastructure states, they are contributing 35.46%, and the remaining 23.04% of total milk produce, it has been contributed by the low milk market infrastructure index states. Then coming to the conclusion, in states like Gujarat, Kerala, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, which market infrastructure index states, are having very good infrastructure in their state, but still there is also a chance of improvement in the extension activities of the better dissemination of any technology or market information in producers level and farmers level also. And in states like Andhra Pradesh, UP and Rajasthan, already they are having a good network of cooperatives and other infrastructure in the state, but still there should be improvement within the cooperatives, like be it in the system provision of assistance for or create of awareness among the farmers regarding cooperatives. As well as there is need to develop the road infrastructure facilities throughout the state also. Then in states like Bihar, Odisha, Goa and Himachal Pradesh, as compared to the area of the states, the number of cooperatives are very low in these states. And the membership, the participation of the people, farmers in cooperatives is very high. So there is a need of more establishment of more number of cooperative societies, as well as there should be increased capacity of chilling infrastructure, which needs to be addressed. and in states like Telangana, Uttarakhand and West Bengal, those who are coming under low market infrastructure states, they need to improve in all aspects of infrastructure, be it in cooperatives or milk procurement or changing infrastructure, road communication, everything in all aspects of infrastructure, these states are need to be strengthened. And the at last the most important thing, surprisingly, Haryana, which is one of the producing of India, still it is living under low market infrastructure. This is the most important reason for it, that due to cooperative network in the state. And the other reason is due to distantly located cooperative society. Haryana is and most of patient, but still the cooperative network is very poor in this state. And the cooperative societies. So ultimately, the farmers are preferring to dispose their milk to locally to the directly to consumers or through any other informal channels of distribution. So in this case, in case of Haryana especially, the overall structural change of marketing sector is needed, which will motivate the farmer to change their preference for marketing to informal marketing sector to organized marketing sector, and which will encourage the farmers for procurement and selling of the milk through cooperative societies, and other infrastructure facilities are also need to be improved. These are the references which I have been considered during the research, and thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Sona, for a very good topic and good presentation. Now I'll call upon the next presenter. Parminder Kaur and Parminder Kaur, dono Parminder Kaur hain.
Good morning, sir.
Okay, you are going to present on resource use efficiency and ground up production, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Okay, your good name. Yahan pe to nahi dikh raha hai, isliye puch raha hu. Participation usme apna naam.
Sir, my name is Parminder Kaur.
Kis naam se register kiya hai aapne?
Parminder Kaur, sir.
It's okay. You can start your presentation. Try to keep the time limit in your mind. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Just 10 minutes, not more than that. Please.
Soumya, you are requested to close your presentation.
Soumya? हेलो सौम्या, आप अपना प्रेजेंटेशन क्लोज करो.
सौम्या, यू हैव नॉट क्लोज योर प्रेजेंटेशन येट. प्लीज क्लोज योर प्रेजेंटेशन.
Is it visible, sir?
Yeah.
Yeah, visible.
Good morning to all of you. My name is Parminder Kaur, and I am going to present my topic, resource use efficiency in groundnut production in Punjab and economic analysis. This is flow chart of my presentation. First of all, introduction, objective, methodology, results and discussion, conclusion. First of all, introduction. Groundnut is an important oilseed crop of the world. It is the fourth most important source of edible oil and third most important source of vegetable oil. India is the fourth leading oilseed producing country in the world, next to USA, China and Brazil, harvesting about 32.10 million tons of oilseed per annum. grown in an area of nearly 26 million hectare with an annual average of 1,224 kg per hectare. India accounted for 19% of oilseed area and 2.7% of oilseed production in the world. Production of edible oil in India was about 7.05 million tons in 2016-17. The total area under oilseed cultivation is 43.1 thousand hectare, while production is 56.8 thousand tons in Punjab, and groundnut was grown in the Hoshiarpur district in a very small area of 1.2 thousand hectares. The productivity of groundnut in Punjab was 816 kg per hectare in 1990-91, which increased to 1739 kg per hectare in 2012-13, and then to 1920 kg per hectare in 2016-17. With the huge potential of this cash crop, there is a need to investigate the resource use efficiency of its producers. Next objective. My first objective is to estimate cost and returns in groundnut production, and second is to estimate resource use efficiency in groundnut production. Methodology: Hoshiarpur district was purposely selected for having the highest area of groundnut in Punjab. Primary data for the year 2017-18 were collected from 60 farmers comprised of 32 small, 14 medium and 14 large farmers from three villages of Punga block of Hoshiarpur district by personal interview method using a specially designed and pre-tested schedule. Multi-stage sampling technique was used for the selection of sample. For the interpretation of cost and returns of different categories of farm, tabular analysis was carried out. The Cobb-Douglas production function of the following farm was considered the most appropriate for the present investigation. The MVP, the resource use efficiency of different resources was evaluated with the help of MVP to factor price ratio. Next, results and discussions. Variable costing production of groundnut on different categories of farm in Hoshiarpur district, Punjab, 2017-18. The highest expenditure was estimated on seed on large farmer, that is 39.83. At overall, it was 37.53% of the total variable cost. And the expenditure on fertilizer was also highest on a large farmer, that is 9.47. In the case of irrigation charges, the medium farmer spend more, that is 0.57, which is more as compared to small farmer and large farmer. The large farmer spend more on human labor, that is 27.55%, and on an average it was 26.74% of the total variable cost. In case of hiring machinery, the small farmer spend more, that is 22.71%, which is highest as compared to medium and large farmers. In case of total variable cost, the small farmer spend more, that is 11,762.49 at average, it was 11,553.2 was estimated in groundnut production. Next, economics of groundnut production on different categories of farm in Hoshiarpur district, Punjab, 2017-18. The main product was the main product was 4.93, and the sale price was 3,607.50 rupees per quintal. The byproduct was 5.01 quintal per acre, and sale price was 88.03 rupees per quintal. At overall, the gross return was 18,226 rupees per acre, and the return over variable cost was 6,354.34 rupees per acre. The input-output ratio was the input-output ratio came to be 1.57 at overall. Estimated parameters on production functions of groundnut production in Hoshiarpur district, Punjab, 2017-18. The coefficient of output elasticity for expenditure on seed and machine use was highly significant on 1% level, while the pesticide was highly significant on 5% level. At overall, the seed and pesticide was highly significant at 5% level, while machine use was highly significant at 1% level. Here, machine use showed negative impact on crop yield as compared to seed and pesticides. The coefficient of multiple determination is 0.46. It indicates that 46% variation in crop yield. Next is marginal value product and marginal factor cost of the variable in inputs on different categories of farm. In case of seed, the ratio of MVP to MFC is greater than one. It indicates that the use of seed was underutilization. In case of pesticide and machine use, the ratio of MVP to MFC estimated was less than one. It means the use of pesticide and machine use was utilized in excess. Next is confusion. The results of the production function reveal that the output elasticity coefficient for expenditure on seed, pesticide, and machine use were significant statistically. The significant elasticity of production with respect to machine use showed the machine use had a negative impact on yield, but seed and pesticide has a positive impact on yield of groundnut. It implies that seed was underutilized, hence increasing the quantity of seed will increase output and increase the profit level, while machinery and pesticide overutilized, hence decreasing their use will help to increase output, thereby profit. The price policy should ensure better minimum support price to groundnut grower for their produce with a view of encourage the increase in area and production. It was envisaged that training to the producer by the KVK will help to update their knowledge on the latest production technology for groundnut crop to attain the optimum use of scarce resources. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Kaur, for a nice presentation. Now we will call up the next presenter, Mr. Ajay Singh. Mr. Ajay Singh is there. Mr. Ajay.
Yes, Ajay has enrolled.
पार्टिसिपेंट में तो दिख रहा है
ही इज देयर
ओके मिस्टर अजय कैन यू हियर मी क्या करें आगे बढ़े हेलो
लेट्स वेट गिव वन मोर कॉल
ओके
Mr. Ajay, are you going to present your paper? Dr. Raju?
Yeah.
I think we shall move to next presentation and we will come back if he is available.
Now we'll call upon
announce next.
Jasmeet Kaur. Jasmeet Kaur is present. Paramveer Singh, next presentation. Hello. मनदीप कौर, मनदीप कौर है?
यस सर, मनदीप कौर।
हाँ, यू कैन स्टार्ट योर प्रेजेंटेशन नाउ। ओके
ओके सर। सर लेट मी शेयर माय स्क्रीन।
ओके
सर, इज इट विजिबल?
या या
या, इट इज विजिबल।
इज नॉट प्रॉपरली सर, वन सेकंड। स्क्रीन देख पर सर, नाउ इट्स विजिबल।
या यू कैन स्टार्ट।
हेलो,
हाँ जी, हाँ जी, दिख रहा है।
ओके सर। सर माई सेल्फ मनदीप कौर, आई एम रिसर्च स्कॉलर at Punjabi University Patiala and Department of Economics, and my topic for presentation is socio-economic profile of farm households in cotton belt of rural Punjab. And firstly, starting with the introduction, the agriculture sector is a leading area that needs a relook and reinvention for its development, and the United Nations development agenda for sustainable development includes 17 sustainable development goals, and out of which 10 are related to the agriculture and farmers' welfare, such as no poverty, zero hunger, good health, gender equality, etc. And agriculture, as we are talking about sustainable growth of agriculture, and agriculture growth shall be sustainable when it meets the socio-economic concerns and improve welfare of farmers and other agriculture workers. And education is a tool that can reach farmers on the prosperous path, and as it would increase their awareness and thus their standard of living. Therefore, the objective of the present study is to analyze the socio-economic profile with a special emphasis on educational farm household, their members in the cotton belt area of rural Punjab. And the methodology I have used in the studies, firstly, primary data was collected from 527 farm households in Punjab, and it is for the period 2016. The sample include 118 national farm households, 126 small, 115 households, and 27 large households. And for the sampling, I have used multi-stage stratified sampling technique, and the data was analyzed by using various statistical tools such as average and percentage, etc. And go to the result and discussion. The first table, it is showing age. Table first, it represents the age and sex-wise composition and average size of family of simple household. In total sample persons, 56 were males and 46.37% were females, and about 69% of the population fell in the age group of 15 to 59 years. It is highlighted by red color words. And average size of the family for all sample farm household was found to be 5.74, and this it was positively related to the size of the landhold. And the next table, and the second table, it represents the social status of farm household, and it shows that cotton belt of rural Punjab had a major proportion, that is 88.46% are falling followers of Sikhism. And further, the study revealed that 87.50% of the household were from general category, 10.58% from backward class, and 1.92% from the scheduled caste. Further, the study highlighted the fact that 60.19% of the sample farm household were a part of joint family system and rest are in the and thus the study revealed the fact that with the breakdown of the joint family system, the size of holding was getting down. The next table, table third, it is indicating the economic status of the members of sample farm household. And it shows that out of the total sample person, 34.96% were earners, 31.39% were earning dependents, and 33.65% were dependents. And the average size of the owned land among all sample farmhouse was 11.50 acres, whereas it was 1.43 acres among the marginal farm household and 31.56 acres among the large farm household. And the next table, it is showing the education status of head of the sample farm household. The study revealed that about 34% of the heads of sample farm household were illiterate and 2.5% had obtained education up to below primary level. And only 0.38% of the sample heads were found to be educated up to post-graduation and professional and technical level. That is shown by, as it is, the proportion is 0.19 for each post-graduation and for professional and technical level. It is, the share is also 0.19% for all the sample farm household. The heads of the sample farm household, they were better educated among the large farm household than the small, marginal and other farm household. And the next table, table fifth, it highlights the educational level of members of sample farm households. And the study showed that 23.01% of the sample persons were illiterate. And study also revealed disturbing fact that only a smaller proportion of persons had obtained education up to had obtained higher levels of education, as it is shown in table that only 4.99% were graduates, 1.25% are attaining post-graduation levels, and only 2.61% have obtained education up to for professional and technical levels. And illiteracy was found to be positively related to the farm size. The next table, table six, it is showing the habits of reading newspaper among the sample farm household. The study worked out the fact that only 11.54% of the sample farm household, they are reading newspaper. And the proportion of farm household reading newspaper was significantly low among marginal and small farm size categories. And it is 2.54% in case of marginal and only 4.76% in case of small farmers who are reading newspaper. As the analysis revealed that majority of the farmers did not have the habit of reading newspaper, it is because of their low education level, it is because of the lack of awareness among them, or in some cases the non-availability of newspaper in the rural areas. So finally, I would like to conclude my study that average size of owned land holding was uneconomic among marginal, small and semi-medium farmers, which requires effective implementation of land reforms in favor of these poor farmers. And all these farmers, they should be provided gainful employment opportunities in the non-agriculture sector also for raising their level of living, for raising their income. And also for improving their social status, as education, we are saying, is a tool that can be helpful in improving the socioeconomic condition of farmers. So it is the duty of the state government that it should take more initiative for providing free and higher as well as technical and professional education to the wards of the marginal, small and semi-medium farmers in particular, and all farmers in general, by providing more incentive to their parents. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mandeep Kaur.
Hello.
Hello. Thank you. Thank you for your nice presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Raju, you may invite next presentation. Dr. Raju, unmute your mic. Dr. Raju. Dr. Raju, unmute your mic,
hello.
Please. Yes, now audible.
Ms. Iqbal Kaur, you can start your presentation. Who is going to present on perception problems of farmers trained for kitchen gardening from KVK Jalandhar? Aap apna presentation start kar sakte hain. इकबाल कौर, आप सुन रहे हो?
हेलो,
हेलो,
हेलो, एम आई ऑडिबल सर?
यस यस
सर, समवन इज शेयरिंग द स्क्रीन, सो दैट्स व्हाई सर आई एम नॉट एबल टू शेयर द स्क्रीन सर. सर अजय,
मिस्टर अजय सिंह, हेलो, आप अपना स्क्रीन शेयर बंद करो. अजय सिंह सुन रहे हो? हेलो अजय सिंह, आप अपना स्क्रीन बंद करो. अजय
is not responding, sir.
Hello?
So host will cancel the screen, sir.
Sir, host ko request karna padega, fir hum nahi kar sakte isko.
Nee, if Ajay is willing to present right now, let us give him opportunity to present first and then we'll come to the Iqbal Kaur.
Okay, okay, no problem, but he is not responding at all. Mr. Ajay?
Hello?
Ajay.
Yes, yes.
Hello?
Yes, yes, who is on the line?
Sir, are you listening, sir?
Yeah, Mr. Ajay Singh?
Yes, sir.
Okay, you are willing to present right now? Hello, you are audible. You can start your presentation now.
Mr. Ajay? Mr. Ajay, say something, whether you are going to present it or not.
Madam Iqbal Kaur, you may try now.
No, sir.
I requested the host to cancel. Try. Okay, yes, visible now.
Yes. Good afternoon to one and all. I'm Iqbal Kaur from Ludhiana, and I'm going to present my research topic, Perception and Problems of KVK Trained Farmers for Kitchen Gardening. First of all, introduction. What is kitchen gardening? Kitchen gardening is defined as a supplementary food production system that is under the management and control of household members, or they are defined as a small-scale supplementary food production system by and for household members, and the mimics the natural and multi-layer ecosystem. According to World Health Organization, the daily per capita income of vegetables in India is 190 gram, whereas for the balanced diet, an adult should have the minimum daily intake of vegetable is 300 grams. Vegetable can play an important role in human nutrition. Intake of fresh vegetable is must in our daily diet. They provide essential nutrients for good health. Kitchen gardening plays an important role for rural families to provide diversified vegetables, fruits, and pulses in their daily diet. A poor family can afford to make beneficial use of kitchen gardening plots, and these plots are likely to make a sustainable contribution to the family's livelihood objectives. Then the study of my objectives are, the first objective is to study the perception of respondents regarding nutritional benefits of kitchen gardening. And the second objective is to study the constraints faced by the farmers regarding kitchen gardening trained by the KVK Jalandhar. Then material and method. The study was conducted only in rural Punjab by taking only one district, that is Jalandhar. The list of 348 trained farmers on kitchen gardening during the period of 2011 to 2015 was obtained from KVK Jalandhar. Out of the procured list, the sample of 200 respondents was selected based on the probability proportional to the number of trainees in each year from the year of 2011 to 2015. The data was collected with the help of personal interview designed for the purpose. The data collected during the period of inquiry was compiled and analyzed systematically, keeping in view with the objectives of the study. Now, the first table is distribution of respondents according to their socioeconomic characteristics. And the first socioeconomic characteristic is age. And majority of the farmers in the percentage 56%. That is lies under the age of above 50, and in education, the majority of the farmer is 58%. That is mostly lies in the matric. That is all the respondents done up to the matric level. Then occupation. Most of the farmers done in the farming. That's why they are doing the kitchen gardening at their backyard or at their farm. Then experience in establishing the kitchen gardening. Majority of the farmers, that is 48.50%, that is lies in the 21 to 28 years of experience in establishing the kitchen gardening. Then family type. The most of the families are nuclear, means that is 58%. Then the family size. The family size will be the 58%, that is up to the 5 members in the family. Then operational land holding. Most of the majority of the farmers have their land in 30%, and that is in operational land holding in medium, that 4 to 10 hectare. Then herd size. Herd size means number of cows and buffaloes in the family, that is 36%. Majority of his 36%, the families have 5 cows or buffaloes and above. Then distributions of respondents according to the perception about kitchen gardening. Then kitchen gardening, the farmers perceive that the kitchen gardening quality vegetables, easy vegetables and the vegetable availability of vegetables around the year and the chemical free vegetables are also produced. If we see the present situation, that is this COVID-19 situation, the the vegetables should be clean, which we are bring from the outside, and then the farmers which are there, they prefer to grow the vegetables at home so that they can be free from that virus or free from that chemical free vegetables they produce. Then the majority of the farmers they also grow the chemical free and easy availability of vegetable is there. Then the farmers perceived that the vegetables are available throughout the year at their home. Then this is the graph which represents the perception according to their what they feel about the kitchen gardening. Then next is the what type of constraints they faced during the while growing the vegetables at their home. Then majority of the farmers faced the problems that the 73% of farmers perceived that the faced the constraints that the vegetables doesn't grow properly during the summers because the attack of insect pest is there. And then 61% is there that frequent induction when there is when the rainy season the kitchen gardening is filled with the water. This can be faced by the farmers. Then some of the farmers faced the problem of proper protection of local animals and grazing when there is the plots in our field and some grazing animals are inside that, then the vegetables can be destroyed by the animals. That problems can be faced by the farmers. Then the major problem is the lack of knowledge about the major insect pests and diseases and their identification, and they don't identify that insect pest and their management. They don't show that the how the management can be there according to this insect pest. Then the distribution of respondents according to the use of surplus kitchen gardening produce. Then most of the farmers share their surplus produce when the vegetables grow in their kitchen gardening and their family size is nuclear. The produce will be shared with the neighbors or relatives or other farmers also used for their making the pickle and some making chutneys and some making is murabbas and some are in the winters there is some leafy vegetables are also they also prefer to dried in that season and used in the further seasons. Then distributions of respondents according to the basis of suggestions given by the respondents regarding kitchen gardening. What are the suggestions given by the farmer? That is majority of the farmers, that is 60% of the farmers growing vegetable seedlings should be provided by KVKs at the reasonable prices. Then the vegetable kit should be available at nominal prices. Then 57% of farmers suggested that pest resistant varieties can be provided in the kit. Some vegetables are resistant that they attack by the insect, like brinjal is there. Then some farmers, that 37% of the farmers suggested that creating awareness among the farmers about kitchen gardening. And some farmers suggested that special training to the women also given by the KVKs. Then at the final, the conclusion is there. The study concluded that problems as perceived by the farmers that vegetable doesn't grow properly during summers due to insect pest problems. The farmers suggested more training for the women, and most of the aged farmers likely to grow fresh vegetables at their home as compared to young farmers. So it is necessary to promote or give training to young farmers. All the farmers perceive that chemical-free and fresh vegetables are available throughout the year, which is beneficial to health. Then most of the farmers share their surplus produce to relatives and friends. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Iqbal Kaur, for your nice presentation and nice topic also. Now let us call upon the next presenter, Mr. Ajay Singh. Mr. Ajay Singh. Ajay Singh, say something. Whether you are going to present?
Hello.
Hello. Yeah.
Yes, Mr. Ajay.
I think Ajay sir have some network problem, so that's why sir he's not connect with us.
Maybe.
Ajay.
Mr. Ajay, start your video and share the PPT. Mr. Ajay, are you here? Dr. Raju, I think we should move for another presentation. Is there any more presentation?
Yeah, let me see. Hello.
Okay, Ajay is sharing. Okay, good one.
Yeah, Ajay, you can start now. Sajay?
Mr. Ajay, you are not audible. Please set your mic.
Ajay, kuch sunai nahi de raha. Aap sun rahe ho?
अजय सिंह सर
तो सुनाई नहीं दे रहा है। हेलो 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 अजय Something wrong with your audio.
Hello.
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 Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello.
Hello. Sir, you are aiming?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, sir.
You can. You should restart your presentation.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Myself, Ajay Singh.
Yeah, yeah. Start.
My topic is resource use efficiency in wheat under different techniques in Haryana. Wheat is a crop of universal importance in the world. Total area under wheat cultivation was 225 million hectares, and production is Hello.
Yeah, you are audible. Please continue. Mr. Ajay, you may skip introduction part. Coming to objective, methodology, and result.
The selection of the districts, Karnal in methodology, Karnal and Kaithal districts of Haryana were selected purposely on the basis of the highest area under different types of resource conservation establishment technique. Under these crops, under such techniques in these crops such as zero tillage and conventional tillage and turbo happy seeder techniques. Selection of the respondents after selection of villages, the list of those farmers who adopted resource conservation establishment techniques under wheat crop was prepared and classified into three size groups, conventional, zero tillage, and turbo happy seeder techniques. From each group, 40 farmers were selected randomly. Thus, a total of 120 farmers were selected for detailed study to draw the inference. Collection of data. The required primary data for evaluating the specific objectives of the study were collected during the agriculture year 2017 and 18, the information pertaining to the socio-economic status of the sample farmers, human labor, machine, hours, seed, fertilizer, pesticides, insecticide, field and yield and other cost and returns, resource use efficiency and various constraints faced by wheat growers were collected from these three techniques, sample farmer, analytical techniques, production function analysis was employed to estimate resource use efficiency of wheat wheat cultivation. The production function was Cobb-Douglas production function model is used to calculate the resource use efficiency of wheat under different techniques. First of all, results and discussion. Two districts were selected, Karnal and Kaithal. The coefficients in Karnal, human labor, machine labor, seed cost, fertilizer cost, plant protection, irrigation, and return to scale, these factors are calculated in my research paper. The return to scale the coefficient in conventional technique in Karnal district was 9.353 and for human labor it is 0.203 and like this return to scale in Karnal district comes decreasing return to scale and in same ways canal and cathode district results were same. The return to scale is decreasing, and in especially turbo happy shader technique, the return to scale is increasing, is more than one marginal value productivity of various inputs in wheat cultivation in Karnal district of Haryana. In each technique, 20 farmers were selected from two districts. First of all, in conventional technique in Karnal, marginal value productivity for human labor is more than one, but in machine labor is less than one, and seed cost more than one, and fertilizer cost is non-significant and negative, and for plant protection it is more than one, and irrigation more than one. Likewise, all results are calculated, and in special technique, turbo happy shader technique, its the results are coming more than from both the techniques. Now for marginal value of productivity of various inputs in wheat cultivation in cathode districts of Haryana. First of all, for cathode district in conventional technique, the results for all the factors come more than one and significant, and the difference between these MVP and price comes here less than one, and in machine labor negative, and for seed cost it is 5% significant, and in plant it is 5% significant, and for irrigation it comes 10% significant. The standard error for marginal value productivity for human labor is less than one, and it comes all less than one, and for decreasing type. In same way, zero tillage technique, both the technique results are same, but in turbo happy shader technique, the difference is more significant, but in case of fertilizer, it is very very negative. More fertilizers are used in turbo happy shader techniques, but irrigation is used very less. Only three irrigations are providing by the farmers in turbo happy shader technique.
Ajay, you are not audible. Ajay, we are unable to listen to you.
Hello.
Yeah. Please continue.
Okay, sir. Conclusions. Regression coefficients of inputs of seed, plant protection, and irrigation were found to be positive and significant, whereas machine labor and fertilizer were positive. Found to be positive and significant, whereas machine labor and fertilizer were positive, but with a non-significant impact on wheat yield for conventional technique. in wheat. In the case of zero tillage techniques, seed plant protection and irrigation were observed with significant effect, whereas fertilizer have negative significant effect on wheat yield. While in the case of turbo happy seeder technique, machine labor, seed and irrigation were found to be positive and significant, whereas fertilizer and plant protection was found negative without significant effect on wheat yield. In the case of the conventional technique, the difference between marginal value product and marginal factor cost for seed, plant protection and irrigation was found to be positive and significant, indicating underutilized usage, whereas machine labor and fertilizer were found to be overutilized in the area. In the case of zero tillage technique, the difference between marginal value product and marginal factor cost for seed, plant protection and irrigation was found to be positive and significant, indicating their underutilized status, whereas fertilizer was found to be overutilized in the area. In the case of turbo happy seeder technique, the difference between marginal value product and marginal factor cost for machine labor, seed and irrigation was found to be positive and significant, indicating its underutilized level, whereas fertilizer and plant protection were found to be overutilized in the region. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Ajay Singh, for a nice presentation. Now, anybody left? I don't think in the participant list, presenter is left. Hello,
sir, Baldeep Singh.
Baldeep Singh, yeah, oh, it's okay. You can start your presentation. An economic analysis of layer farming in Punjab?
Haan ji, haan ji, sir.
Okay, you can start your presentation.
Ajay, first close your PPT. Ajay, you are requested to close your PPT.
Yes, sir, yes.
You share your slides and then start your presentation.
Hello, good afternoon to everyone.
Yeah.
I am audible to all. Hello.
Haan ji, sun rahe hain.
Okay, sir. I am Baldeep Singh, PhD research scholar, Dharan University, Bardusa. My presentation topic on economics and analysis of layer farming in Punjab. First of all, contact, introduction, objective, material and method, result and discussion, conclusion. Introduction. The poultry industry in India has emerged in vibrant, techno-friendly and profitable agro industry in recent years. India has third ranked in egg production after China and United States of America in the world.
Dear Baldeep Singh, kindly skip your introduction part. Directly go to methodology and results.
Okay, sir. The objective of study to examine the socioeconomic profile of sample layer farm, and second objective is to estimate the cost and profitable of egg production on different size of poultry farm. Material method, the study was conducted in Punjab state. The primary data will collect from the 100 layer poultry farm in the district of Punjab by applied probability promotion sampling technique. The poultry farms are categorized into three groups, namely small, medium, large, by using the cumulative square root frequency. In order to fulfill the objective of study, summation, average percentage, benefit cost ratio, and break-even point were completed to ascertain the behavior of data. Result and discussion. Table first, distribution of sample layer farm. In this table, the small category layer farm were selected 22 and they have average flock size 10,410 per unit. And 33 medium category layer farm were selected and they have average flock size was 30,252 per unit. And 25 large layer farm were selected, they have average flock size was 70,200. Table 2, socioeconomic profile of sample layer farm. In this table, the overall layer farm age group 41 to 60 year worth 49% followed by the age group of 40 up to 40. There was 33% and the age group of above 60 at 20% share. The education level of a person played an important role in the adoption of the latest farm technology, and education level up to matric level was found 59% and 41% layer farm got the higher education standard. The 91% overall layer farm engaged in poultry farming and agriculture was a main occupation. The only 9% layer farm engaged in poultry farming and service sector. The overall 38 layer poultry farm is living in the joint family system. Table 3, the investment pattern on building equipment and machinery on sample layer farm. In this table, the total building cost had a maximum value of large layer farm, followed by medium layer farm and small layer farm. This indicates the capital intensive nature of the large farm. The basic various type of equipment that were necessary required for were being used for layer farming. The investment on equipment item include broding for heating and cooker and sprinkle was the tune of ₹0.09 and 0.20 lakh per farm and 0.18 and 0.44 lakh per farm and 0.37 and 1.35 lakh per farm on small, medium and large respectively. And overall average size was 0.21 and 0.66 lakh per farm respectively. The miscellaneous item include the plastic seat for weather shifting and trolley, tubal lights, spray pump, basket and the slower highest for large layer farm followed by the medium and medium layer per farm and small layer per farm. The feed grinder machine and mixer machine was required for preparation of feed at the farm and mix the integrator itself. The expenditure on grinding and mixing machine was highest on large layer farm ₹0.52 lakh and 3.49 lakh, followed by medium layer farm and small layer farm. The overall basis, the mixer machine was more costly, ₹1.73 lakh as compared to grinder machine. The investment on other machine involved fan, generator for electricity and inverted port office use was observed highest for large layer farm as compared to medium and small layer farm. The table 4, cost of egg production. On category on sample layer farm per bird, it is observed that the poultry feed followed by the poultry feed was the most important item of the variable cost, which was accounting for 65% of the total maintenance cost of layer production. This was found declining across the farm. In case of poultry feed, no specific trend was observed. Though it was the second highest component of maintenance layer for egg production, the cost incurred on day-old chicks being the waste for egg production was noticed to be the third important component of variable cost, for which the figure both in absolute and percentage term was found increased with the size of poultry. Human labor was another important item, which is accounting for 3.72, 3.00 and 2.64% to the total. All the other level of share of human labor was the extent of 3.12% across the farm. These costs were decreasing due to economics of scale. The proportion of expenditure incurred on medicine and vaccine was extended to be 0.82, 0.88 and 0.89 for the small to large layer farm, and it was accounting for the overall 0.86%. The electricity and diesel charge accounting for 0.76% for total variable cost for the average total sample. The electricity was very essential for lighting of tube fan running the motor of grinding and mixer. This cost was very for place to place and farm to farm in different district of the Punjab. The other electricity and diesel expenses were ₹7.57 per word, which was constituted was 0.76% of the total variable cost. Fuel for broader included sawdust, wood block and gas, which was required for maintain the temperature of the layer set. The temperature directly affected the production of the cost incurred. Fuel for broader was ₹0.70 per word for overall layer farm, which constitute.
Mr. Baldev Singh, we are running short of time. Please do hurry. Kindly go directly to the conclusion.
So, socioeconomics profile of sample layer farm, the majority of head of the family is found active labor force. Maximum poultry farm was matric level education standard, and 3/4 of the respondent engaged poultry farming and agriculture is the main occupation. Investment pattern per bird was highest for large layer farm as compared to medium and small layer farm. There was a direct relationship between investment and the size of farm, which indicates the higher level of capitalization invested by the large layer unit. The per bird variable charge was comparatively low in large layer farm as compared to medium layer farm and small layer farm due to extensive of economics of scale. The fixed cost per bird, which was lowest for small layer farm followed by medium and large layer farm due to region, this cost decline with increase in the size of farm, revealing the absence of scale of economics in the study area. The gross turn per bird from layer farming was highest for the small layer farm followed by medium and large layer farm. The income from the layer product per bird showed the decreasing trend with the size of farm. The input output ratio over total cost and break-even quantity was highest for large layer farm followed by medium and small layer farm. The proportion gap between break-even point and actual production was decreasing according to incline the size of category. The layer farm is a high capital intensive enterprise with the capital investment in the medium large scale being a high profitable business. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Baldev Singh, for your cooperation and nice presentation. Now we will move to the discussion part. Now house is open for discussion, please. We will take only two questions from each presentation. First, we will start from presentation, first presenter, Mr. Raj Deshwal. Raj, yes, are you here?
Yes, sir, I am here.
Okay. Kindly raise your hand, those who are willing to ask question. Raj's presentation was on overview of agribusiness industry in India, opportunity and challenges. Is there any question from participant side? Any question, any query? Is there any query related to the paper overview of agribusiness industry in India, opportunity and challenges?
Hello, yes.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Mr. Raj. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Is it a study conducted by you or it was a review study?
It's a review study and most of the part and data are secondary.
It's okay.
Raj, if there is no query from participant side, I have a small question.
Yes.
After liberalization, private investment has decelerated. Why it is so?
The problem is that agriculture industry, the productivity is low in comparison to the other industries like construction, manufacturing and other. So even after liberalization, the FDI investment or the participant from the private sector is low. As agriculture is important and there is, I mean, about 58% of the population is engaged in it. So government have to invest to maintain the industry.
Okay, one more thing. You have mentioned that there is a lack of research.
Yes.
Probably you might be knowing, we have a ICR system, one of the biggest system in Asia, and also the SAUs.
Yes.
How you can say lack of research? What do you suggest?
Lack of research is not in the part of the production, but when we come across the agribusiness industry, it also includes the input side and the market and trade marketing side. There is less intervention of government also because no good research in comparison to how the investment is done in other industries. Agricultural research part and education part in agribusiness sector is very low.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Any other query? Shall we move to the next presentation? Presentation by Afreen. Or distributional and determinants of land follows among the farmers of central dry zone of Karnataka. Any question from audience side? Dr. Raju?
Yes, sir.
This is related to your subject.
Koi sunai nahi de raha. Aapka kuch problem hai.
Dr. Raju?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Would you like to comment on it?
No, thanks.
Okay.
We'll go to next presentation.
Okay, we can go to next presentation. Next presentation by Kuldeep Singh on role of research and development in sustaining Indian agriculture.
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is there any question? From the audience side. If there is no question, we'll move to the next presentation. Saumya Mahapatra.
Jaskreen.
Hello.
Jaskreen. You have some overview. It would be better. I have a suggestion for you.
Yes, sir.
It would be better if you estimate the contribution of R&D to TFP.
Sir, can you please repeat?
It would be, I have a small suggestion for you.
Yes, sir.
You estimate the contribution of R&D in agriculture to the total factor productivity.
Okay, sir.
You have given the overview of this. Your presentation was very good. But that is based on the review. Your work itself was not there.
Okay.
Otherwise, it was a good presentation.
Okay.
Okay, we will move to the next presentation. Next presentation by Parminder Kaur. Resource use efficiency in ground rent production in Punjab and economic analysis.
Yes, sir.
You are here?
Yes,
Parminder
sir.
Kaur?
Yes, sir.
Okay, any question from audience side?
Yes, sir, I have. Mandeep Kaur.
Mandeep Kaur, okay, Mandeep, please ask the question.
Yeah. Sir, I want to ask from Ms. Parminder that as she has used 7% interest rate for variable cost,
Yes. And how you use that 7% proportion?
Because farmer were getting loan at a 7% interest rate.
Actually, I had studied in a course on manual on cost of cultivation. And okay. It was mentioned there that for working capital, that is, or we can say for variable cost, 12.5% interest rate for the half the duration of crop is charged.
But when I was conducted a study, they were said me 7% interest rate. Farmer were getting at 7% interest rate.
Okay, you use them. Whatever interest is interest.
Where they are getting at 7% rate of interest.
Yes, sir.
Whether they are getting from nationalized bank or private agencies, which financing institutions are lending at 7%?
Sir, they get loan. They was getting get loan from cooperative banks and some government banks.
Is the rate of interest 7%?
Yes, sir.
It is lower side. His point is valid. Manpreet point is valid. This is on lower side. Okay. You may revisit on this.
Okay, sir.
Sir, actually, I am also conducting a course of cultivation. So I was studied there. It was 12.5% something for the half the duration of crop. And I was confused in it. So I want to clear that. And also in irrigation charges.
Near to the bank interest rate.
Sir, actually 12.5% interest rate from private banks, sir, not government and cooperative societies.
Okay. It is, and it irrigation seems to be on higher side. It should be between 8-10%, and not more than that.
Okay, sir.
And my next question is that how you calculated irrigation charges as irrigation electricity is free to the farmer in Punjab?
Yes, they use a diesel engine for irrigation.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Welcome.
Parminder.
Yes, sir.
I have a small question for you.
Yes, sir.
You have mentioned that machine use is excess use of machinery. What it means? Overutilization of machinery.
Sir, actually, it actually pura jo hamara estimation hai wo resource use efficiency ka wo expenditure par hai, monetary value hai sir. Wo monetary value mein kya hai ki sir kuch bahut sare aise hain farmer, large farmer jaise aapne dekha hoga kam hai, to bahut sare jo small farmer hai wo hire karte hai sir machinery ko. तो इसलिए वो नेगेटिव में जा रहा है क्योंकि उसका प्राइस ज्यादा है तो वो नेगेटिव इंपैक्ट दे रहा है क्रॉप को.
बट इट डज नॉट मीन ओवर यूटिलाइजेशन ऑफ मशीन.
ओके सर.
यू नीड टू इंटरप्रेट इन अ डिफरेंट मैनर.
ओके सर.
ओके.
ओके
शैल वी मूव टू द नेक्स्ट प्रेजेंटेशन बाय अजय सिंह. अजय आर यू हियर? Mr. Ajay, there is a question for you. Dr. Senthil is here. He is willing to ask some question from you. Dr. Senthil. Ajay, kindly unmute your mic.
Sir, am I audible?
You are audible.
Yeah, so I have one question for Shyajit Singh regarding the resource use efficiency topic.
Yeah.
The topic is good, but as I already posted in the chat, that the sample size is
yeah,
good.
Yeah, we received your chat.
Yeah, 20 is not it's not justifiable because the degrees of freedom, it will be, close to 12 or 13,
right,
so that
right.
Will not give a reliable result. So the researcher has to take care of this kind of issue while framing a regression model.
Right, right.
So rest
right.
of the presentations are good, and of course, thank you.
Ajay, I think you might have noted the point of Dr. Senthil. Okay. Any other question? Any other query related to his presentation? Then we move to the next presentation given by socioeconomic profile of farm household in cotton belt of rural Punjab, Manpreet Kaur.
Sir, Mandeep Kaur.
Mandeep Kaur, sorry, Mandeep. Any question? Any observation? Very important area. No one is asking question.
I have a question that in a slide there is one thing that average.
Kindly introduce yourself. Kindly introduce yourself.
Sir, myself Raj Jaiswal.
Okay, Raj.
Yes, sir. I have a question that in the slide the average size of the family that is.
Yes, sir.
For marginal, it is on lower side, and when we go to the large farmers, the size of the family is increasing.
So, yes, sir.
Do you think that in future the large family size means large farmer, they will distribute the land among their children and they become sometimes means in
category? Sir, definitely. That will come down as when I studied the area, means when I collected the data, those yeah. farmers who are large, they are means they are joint family, they have joint family system.
Yeah.
So whenever they will be in nuclear family, so there will be the size of the land holding become uneconomic, that will be getting down.
Okay, means those who are large family, large farmers, they have a joint family. That's why they are large.
Sorry, sir?
Means those who are in large farmer category, most of them are in a joint
family. Sir, most of the cases I have studied that those who are large farmer, they are living jointly. They are two brothers, means like that. Means in one of the cases I have found that it was in Fazilka that where there are 65 acres a farmer has, but he had three sons.
Yeah.
And when they will be separated, definitely the area of their land size that will be get down in the future.
Yeah, that the similar thing is.
But still, for the present, they are living as they are small children. They are living jointly.
Yeah, that's the thing is also visible in educational status, like that those who are marginal, they are less literate or having the category of education in primary and middle higher. And in large farmers, it is that most of them are up to the middle level of education.
Sir, I'm not getting the question. Where education?
No, just I am saying that.
Okay.
Yeah, it was not question, but just it is an interpretation about your data.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay, any other query? We move to the next presentation on perception and problems of farmers trained for kitchen gardening presented by Iqbal Kaur. Any observation by the participants, organizers? Iqbal Kaur, you are here? Iqbal Kaur? Okay, then move to the next. An economic analysis of layer farming in Punjab by Baldev Singh.
Yes, sir.
Any question from audience side, please?
Thank you.
Iqbal. Baldev Singh.
Yes, sir.
How you perceive the impact of COVID on layer farming?
Sorry, sir.
How you perceive the impact of COVID-19 on layer farming?
Sir, it's touched on the too much because in the case of Punjab, the daily production is 1.59 crore. So,
okay.
The daily need of poultry human being is 30 gram, but in the case of COVID, they are getting only 18 gram. So the COVID-19 affects that the 50% of sale effect on the layer farming.
50% sale was affected.
50% in the Punjab. 50%. This is data in the Punjab.
Okay. Then how it affect the prices?
So the price, there are no effect because on the prices. What is the effect on the sale? The, maybe it's effect on 20 to 10 rupees decrease on a per tray.
Per tray. Okay, thank you. Any other question? Now one more presentation given by Soumya Mahapatra. Role of milk market infrastructure for sustainable dairy development. Soumya, sir, you are here?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir, I have a question for Soumya.
Yeah.
Nice presentation, but in between I missed your presentation. So I just want to know that you have also taken coverage by private sector or you have considered only cooperatives?
It is for the selection of indicators, what the 10 indicators which I have been from physical and institutional infrastructure. So from physical infrastructure, I have selected road communication networks and the cooperative societies, which are cooperative sector. Actually, this research is exclusively based on secondary data. So the data, based on the data availability from the different authentic sources only, I have taken the data regarding the cooperative societies. Actually, ma'am, cooperative societies, it represents the institutional infrastructure framework of that particular state.
Okay, so what I noticed in your results, no, the states who are having a strong cooperative network, they are good in the index of this marketing infrastructure also.
Right.
Actually, my
infrastructure. Your voice is not clear, Soumya. Hello?
Ma'am, can you hear
me? Yeah. I think there is some problem with your audio. We can discuss this later. Thank you.
Soumya, please respond, Soumya, if possible. Soumya, you presented well. At the same time, what Dr. Kunjan asking, I have a similar query. For instance, Haryana states comes under low index, no market index.
Yes, sir.
While the Bihar, Odisha under the moderate. Why it is so?
Yes, sir.
Probably you have touched only the cooperative infrastructure.
Actually, I have focused on the formal marketing sector rather than the informal marketing sector, because in formal sector, the profits which are gained by the farmers, it is more than the informal sectors due to involvement of more number of intermediaries in that informal marketing channel. That is why
private sector also comes under formal sector. It is not informal sector. Informal sector is the one, like if you are marketing it through milk vendor and all, then it will come under normalized sector or informal sector. Under formal, we have both cooperative sector and private sector. And I think you have not included private sector because of that Haryana is coming in the lowest category. Lowest because category, their cooperative is not that strong.
Similar yes. kind of concern I have.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Now, Soumya.
Let Raju, please.
The same question, You have constructed an index for Haryana and it is coming under low milk market infrastructure. Based on your study, what do you suggest? What kind of infrastructure should be improved in Haryana to bring it in the upper state?
Sir, I would like to suggest that as per the high milk production in the state, so as compared to that milk production, the number of cooperatives should be improved and the infrastructural facilities within the cooperatives should be increased. It is not like the farmer has to travel a long distance for disposal of milk through cooperatives.
Why you are not included northeastern states in your study?
Sir, this study is based on secondary data, availability of secondary data. This is not from primary study. So, based upon the availability of data for all the indicators, for consecutively for 3 years, on the basis of that only, I have excluded the northeastern states.
It's okay. Anyhow, congratulations for nice presentation.
Thank you,
sir. Okay.
Any other remarks, Dr. Raju?
Oh, it's okay.
Okay, now it is time to close this session. I am extremely thankful to all the participants. They have nicely presented. In these sessions, 9 papers were presented and all were good. I also thankful to co-chair Dr. Raju and reporter Dr. Gunjan Bhandari. Organizers have given us one tough task. We have to select one best presentation. Though all were very good, but we have to select one. If get selected, then it's okay. If not, please don't mind. Your presentation was not so good. Don't think like that. But there are still scope to improve. Each one can improve in a different way. My best wishes to all speakers. And now I close this session. Thank you, one and all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Except will 2 baje milna hai.
Yeah, sir. 2 baje at 2. Okay.
Thank you. अगर कुछ query है आप आपस में phone कर सकते हैं कोई बात.
हाँ, yeah.
Regarding selection of the
person. Right. We can.
Okay. 2 baje. Privately.